Welcome to Opera 101. I'm Leia Edwards, General Director of Holy City Arts and Lyric Opera.
And I'm Dimitri Pitas, Artistic Director, and today is obviously Election Day.
Vote and Wagner both start with the same sound, so we thought today would be a great day to introduce you to, or reacquaint you with, a composer who shaped the art form with his ideas, both musically as well as dramatically.
And you're especially lucky because Richard Wagner is in our hostess Margaret Fournier's wheelhouse, so you are going to learn things that only true Wagnerian fans know.
So sit back, relax, and take it away, Margaret.
Today, we are tackling a very important, but also very complicated subject, Richard Wagner. We really cannot study opera without taking a look at the works of Wagner. His influence on opera and music is astounding, whether you like him or not. Liking him is probably not an issue if you are referring to the man as a person. He had a totally objectionable personal life, being an extreme egotist and treating people badly. The age-old moral dilemma is, can you forgive or excuse even a rare genius his thoroughly objectionable personal life? Well, we are not here to resolve or even discuss that part of Wagner, but to explore his genius and his influence on not only his contemporaries, but all who followed him. Wagner is one of the most controversial figures in all of opera, both artistically and politically. He challenged all understanding of the arts during the 19th century and left an indelible influence. Now, Wagner was not only a composer, but also a poet and philosopher. As we have looked at other composers during our classes, we have also mentioned the librettist who wrote the script. Well, Wagner wrote all his own libretti. What he wanted to achieve was a complete fusion of music, poetry, and philosophy. He was a man of the theater, theatrical genius. He wanted to throw out old traditions and create his great music dramas, the synthesis of all the theatrical arts. Wagner concluded that what was wrong with the operas of the early 19th century was that drama had become nothing more than an excuse for the performance of music. Wagner intended to reverse this and to create music dramas in which music would serve the purposes of drama. Therefore, ideally, the orchestra would be invisible and the action on stage would be deeds of music made visible. These unprecedented works required a new breed of singer, his huge roaring orchestra, and the endurance to sing his marathon roles. The challenges for singers, orchestral musicians, opera houses, and audiences then are significant. What makes Wagner's operas different from Italian Romantic operas is that the music and drama is continuous. There are no breaks for arias or duets or ensembles. Everything moves along as a whole piece. The orchestra is of equal, if not more, importance than the singers. He uses his orchestras, which are always very large, in the most innovative ways. The orchestra is really the main storyteller. Many non-Wagnerites often say they don't like Wagner because there's no melody. Well, Wagner wrote some of the most beautiful and stirring melodies ever. They can be mesmerizing and very emotional. The difference is they are usually expressed in the orchestra instead of by the singers. Wagner realized that it was possible to sidestep the issue of romance civilization by building upon the artistic achievements of the Greeks. So he looked back far beyond the Middle Ages to the arts of the Lyric Age of Greece, and in particular, the Athenian tragedy. Wagner developed a theory that the separate arts, the primary trio of poetry, music, and dance, and the secondary trio of painting, sculpture, and architecture had once been united in the dramas of ancient Greece. Wagner started out composing operas in the traditional fashion. As his theories began to develop, Wagner had what is called his middle stage output. This began with The Flying Dutchman in 1843, followed by Tannhäuser in 1845, and Lohengrin in 1850. These three operas are sometimes referred to as Wagner's romantic operas. These three are considered to represent a significant developmental stage in Wagner's musical and operatic maturity as regards the thematic handling, the portrayal of emotions and orchestration, even though they contain elements of romantic opera of the day. These three are probably the more liked by non-Wagner fans than the mature ones, because the music is much more accessible. At this point, we should look at the most frequent themes in Wagnerian operas. This will carry through most of his whole output. Number one was his fascination with German history, culture, myths, and legends. He used what he wanted from these sources to make up his stories. Number two, coming to terms with some aspect of the human condition. Number three, man's often frustrated quest for a woman who will give him unconditional love, redemption that comes only from pure and unconditional love. And number four is good versus evil, sacred versus the profane. Now, we sampled The Flying Dutchman last week in our Halloween class, so we will not revisit that. But you will recall that all the themes mentioned above were present. The first opera we will look at is Lohengrin. Based, of course, on myths and legends, the title character is a knight of the Holy Grail who longs for human love. This is a very strong emphasis and differentiation between good and evil in this opera. It's also considered to be his last romantic opera, so it's filled with gorgeous music, arias, and huge, magnificent choruses. To introduce this opera, we will listen to an aria by a completely different composer. This is from Bellini's Norma. Wagner's favorite romantic opera and one that influenced him deeply. This was not only Bellini's favorite of his own operas, but Wagner's as well. Wagner said this opera rises to greatest heights of lyricism in the aria Costa Diva. The simplicity and directness of Bellini's art led Wagner to express great enthusiasm for Norma, which reminded him of the dignity of the Greek tragedy. The music is noble and great, simple and grandiose in style. Norma, a visionary, has secretly conceived two children with the proconsul of the Romans and thus broke her vow of chastity as a Druid priestess. Tonight she cuts the mistletoe and announces the will of the god Imrencil. At full moon, Norma begs the chaste moon goddess for peace. This aria is set in the moonlight. Bellini's orchestral accompaniment is understandable by the restraint of the orchestration and gives a dramatic meaning to the text and thus to the ritual of the Druids. We will listen to Costa Diva and then go right into an aria from Lohengrin. The lady here is Elsa, who is given the opportunity to defend herself in court after being falsely accused of killing her brother. Instead of defending herself, Elsa tells of her grief over the death of her brother and of a dream that a knight will appear who will fight for her and prove her innocence. Listen for the similarities in the lyricism, legato, and atmosphere of these two arias. Next, we'll hear some music, very familiar music. By the way, much of Wagner's music will be familiar to you because it has been quoted and used for so many purposes. This chorus is sung in Lohengrin by the women of the wedding party after the ceremony as they accompany the heroine Elsa to her bridal chamber. We know it more frequently as a piece played on the organ instead of sung. Wagner's piece was made popular when it was used as a processional at the wedding of Victoria, the Prince Frederick William of in 1858. This is much more sensual and suggestive in the opera than it was ever meant to be in church. But here comes the bride.
Thank you.
The next of Wagner's romantic operas we will look at is Tannhäuser. Tannhäuser, by the way, is the first Wagnerian opera that was performed in the United States in 1859. The themes are typically Wagner, sacred versus profane love, seeking redemption through love of a pure woman, and finding salvation in death. Tannhäuser is a tragic parallel of the endless conflict in the soul of man between those impulses which are earthbound and sensual and those that are more spiritual. Although there is much to reflect on Wagner's arias, ensembles, pageantry, choruses, and marches. Tannhäuser is based on two German legends. Tannhäuser, the mythological medieval German mini-singer and a poet, and the tale of the Wartburg Song Contest. The musical themes most featured are the Pilgrim's Chorus, representing the sacred, and the very active music, which signifies the orgies going on in Venusberg, the profane. The overture is one of the most popular and often heard in concerts. It is beautiful, varied, and majestic. A portion of the overture will lead us right into a modern-day film based on Wagner operas and featuring music from many, including the Tannhäuser Overture. It will illustrate the familiar nature of so much of Wagner's music because it is quoted so often. This film is animated and has been widely praised as one of the greatest that Warner Brothers ever released. I hope this helps to illustrate that even if you think you don't know Wagner's music, you have actually heard it often. And we'll add some fun and mirth to all this.
Thank you. longing burns deep inside me.
Return, my love. I want you always beside me.
Love like ours must be.
The title of the cartoon is What's Opera, Doc? It was released in the top 50 animated cartoons of all time. In 1992, the Library of Congress deemed it culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant and selected it for preservation in the National Film Registry, the first cartoon to receive such honors. We have in it an amalgamation of characters as well as music, including music from Tannhäuser, especially from the different themes in the overture. Next, we're going to hear an aria by one of the characters whose name is Wolfram, who along with Tannhäuser is also in love with the woman Elizabeth. Here, he sings the most famous aria from the opera. It sounds old-fashioned now, but at the time it was written, it was quite harmonically innovative. Wolfram is musing on the evening falling on the valley and foreshadowing death. He sings to one fair star whose friendly beam beckons. In the end, the pure woman, Elizabeth, has sacrificed her life to save Tannhäuser. A band of pilgrims enters, bearing Elizabeth's bier. Tannhäuser finally receives forgiveness for his sins and dies. A whole assembly unites in the pilgrim's song, singing a chorus in praise of the miracle. This is really knock your socks off Wagnerian music.
Yeah.
We have looked at Wagner's earlier works before what is called the big stuff. We will now take what we have heard so far and contrast it with what is yet to come. Tristan and Isolde is considered by some to be the quintessence of Wagner's theories. This is the opera that most feel he came very closest to fulfilling his theories. An extremely important work, a real milestone in the history of opera. Few works in history of Western music have so potently affected succeeding generations of composers. More has been written about Wagner than any other composer, I think I'm safe in saying, but no single work has more written about it than Tristan and Isolde. It is subject to endless interpretations and viewpoints. Remember that Wagner wanted to achieve was complete fusion of music, poetry, and philosophy. The ruling ideal is the oneness of music and drama as completely connected expressions of a single dramatic idea. The action of the drama has an inner and an outer aspect. The inner aspect is the province of the orchestra, while the sung words make it clear the particular events that are happening. Understanding the inner and outer aspects of Wagner's music dramas is very important to understanding and enjoying Tristan and Isolde. Very little happens on stage. What is happening is inside the two lovers, and this is apparent through the orchestra. To explain this further, I have to address a very important musical device that Wagner did not actually invent, but he used to an extent no one else had or has since. This is called a leitmotif, or a leading motive. These are snippets of melodies that identify situations, objects, or emotions. The orchestra refers to them often, no matter what is going on stage. These are reflective of the thought and feelings going on inside the characters. They provide a strong subconscious force that makes us feel something without even realizing it. Tristan is full of extremes, extreme emotions, extreme demands on the orchestra, and absolutely brutal on the singers. Not to mention on the audience, since it is 5 hours long. The opening measure of the prelude are the most written about, discussed, thought about of any measure in the history of Western music. This is called the celebrated Tristan chord, about which tomes have been written. These few notes have caused generations of music scholars to become embroiled in trying to figure out what key it is in and what Wagner was up to. It is said to depict the self-perpetuating nature of desire, which is what the audience will be dealing with for the next several hours. Nothing like this had ever been heard before. What makes it so strange is that it causes unbearable tension because it never resolves. This tension lasts through the whole opera. Let's take a listen to this chord right now. One of the most amazing things about the music, and the reason this work was so controversial, such a benchmark for future composition, is revealed in the constant musical tension that begins with that chord. From the beginning of the prelude, there is a feeling of the frustration of unsatisfied longing, and it builds and continues throughout the work, until the end, when final resolution is such a relief, a peace that is sublime. The way Wagner does this is by endless harmonic chromaticism. that stretched the tonal system to the very limit, and of course paved the way for modern music, in which dissonance was not only okay, but the norm. Our system of tonality causes us to have expectations in music. Music is full of tension and release. We expect certain sounds to resolve to certain places, kind of like home base. Well, there is no home base in this work until we get to the very end, and then it is truly sublime. The actual story is pretty simple. Tristan and Isolde fall in love, but Isolde is on her way to marry the king, for whom Tristan is a loyal knight. The two can't stay away from each other and are caught in a love tryst by King Mark. The ensuing fight leaves Tristan severely wounded and near death. Isolde arrives at Tristan's side just in time to witness his death. She follows him in death. When the opera opens, Tristan and Isolde are on a ship. Isolde is being transported to marry King Mark. She does not want to go. She and Tristan have a history that I won't go into much now, but she decides that they will both drink poison. Her maid, though, substitutes a love potion for the death potion, which the two drink. As they drink, we have a great example of leitmotif. This is called the love glance or look motive. This is also a good example of the inner and outer aspects of the music. The two are just recovering from drinking the love potion and are stunned and love struck. This motive will be expressed by the orchestra in different ways throughout the opera to remind us of this moment, but it is describing what is going on in the hearts and minds of Tristan and Isolde. They look at each other and there is no mistake in the music about what is going on, and feel the tension. To illustrate the importance of this work and how and why it changed music composition without playing too much, because I know that some of the music is not easily accessible to everyone. Now we're going to go to the very end. Tristan is mortally wounded. Isolde arrives just before he dies. This is where she sings the most well-known part of the opera called the Liebestod, or love death. This is Isolde's moment of highest bliss as she gazes on Tristan's peaceful, smiling eyes and dies with him. All the elements are here. The motives, the constant swirling tension that goes from timid murmurings to rapture, the building and building, and final sublime release, which comes in the orchestral ending. Wagner finally resolves the Tristan chord as we listen to just a short version of the aria at the end. The music finally finds home base that we have been seeking for so long in the orchestra. Remember, too, as regards the singer's voice, this is sung at the end of a 5-hour opera, and the whole aria is quite long and demanding. And in typical Wagnerian fashion, listen to the orchestra she has to sing over. Release of tension. Now, to something that's we played in the beginning, in the early operas, were some beautiful choruses. But in his more mature works, there aren't any choruses, or not many. But I want to leave you with something joyful today. So this is one of his last operas, and it's a glorious chorus from Wagner's only comedy called Die Meistersinger von Nuremberg. This is also his only work about regular people, actual historical people, rather than myth and legend. He even reverts to some older forms in this magnificent work, like choruses. The opera Tannhäuser was based on a song contest, but in a very dramatic presentation. Die Meistersinger is based on a song contest, but this time it is more comic and lighthearted in treatment. At the very end, we have a huge gathering for the song contest, and all the Meistersingers have marched in with great ceremony, beautiful sets and costumes, and much grandeur. The prize is awarded to the winner, who at first refuses, but the leader, Hans Sachs, convinces him to accept. He sings a very long aria in which he takes pains to point out that rules and discipline are so important in art. He extols all the virtues of German art, which ends with the people's acclaim of Sachs in the grand finale. This music is breathtakingly beautiful.
Majestät, kein Fürst ward mehr sein Volk versteht. Und welchem Dunst, mit welchem Tand, sie pflanzen uns in deutsches Land. Was deutsch und echt ist Deutsche
We have only touched on the genius of Wagner. His most monumental work is the Ring Cycle, a series of four operas that total about 15 or 16 hours and is often featured in a 7-day period. This work is at least one whole class by itself, so I won't get into it here. But tune in next week. We are so fortunate to have an interview with one of the most prominent Wagnerian sopranos of our day, Christine Gerke. I'm sure we will hear more about The Ring from her, as well as many other wonderful insights into Wagner and his music. And if anyone of you would be interested in a class on The Ring, please let us know. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Margaret. It is amazing that we have only just scratched the surface of Wagner's offerings to the operatic world.
As Margaret said, next week's class will be a great conversation with the one and only Christine Gerke. Christine's career and rise to the most prominent American Wagnerian soprano is epic, as is her sense of humor.
We hope you'll tune in next week, and in the meantime, go visit our website at www.holycityarts.org. And now, class is dismissed.
Go vote.